Hello everybody and welcome to another YouTube video. So in this video, I'm going to be giving you a debugging checklist that is going to help you debug your programs, code, application, whatever it may be. This will not be an exhaustive list, but this is just a few key points and things to think about as you're trying to fix and find bugs. With that said, one thing that you can use to help you fix and find bugs quickly is actually the sponsor of this video. Before we get started, I need to thank the sponsor of this video, which is Embold. Embold provides a platform that performs static code analysis and helps you figure out where to start debugging. Embold not only helps you debug your code, but also helps you learn from your mistakes and discover anti-patterns in your work. With its component-level issue flagging, Embold helps you learn best practices, build better architecture, and fix bugs faster. Embold is seamless to use and can be integrated directly into your workflow. It integrates with all of the tools you need, like Git, Visual Studio, Jenkins, Bitbucket, and more. It even has IDE plugins for IntelliJ, Visual Studio, and Android Studio. The best part of Embold, though, is that it's free and it's super easy to get started. You can create an account, link some repositories, and watch Embold point out all of the issues in your code. It's quite impressive the errors it can find, and within a few minutes of using it, it has already shown me many of my mistakes. You can get started with Embold today for free by clicking the link in the description. Thanks again to Embold for sponsoring this video. All right, so let's dive into the video now. I'm about to give you a list that has about 5 or 6 different items on it that should help you find and fix the problems that you're having in your code. Now, of course, debugging is going to be specific to what it is that you're actually debugging. Some things are a lot more difficult than others, and some of these steps may not apply to stuff that you are trying to debug. However, this is kind of a good general rule of thumb to follow, and a lot of these steps only take a few seconds or even minutes, and by kind of considering them at the beginning, you can save yourself a lot of time. All right, so what is step number one, or the first item on my checklist? Well, this is to isolate the problem. Now, this is by far the most important step on this entire list. It is impossible to debug something and to find errors if you do not know what the problem is. So the first thing you should be doing every single time you're trying to fix or find a bug is isolate what the problem actually is and understand the problem deeply. Know how to replicate it, know where it's occurring, know what the actual issue is, and try to grasp the scope of this problem. Is this something that's only affecting a small area of code? Is this affecting the entire application? Is the application still functional? You need to understand the problem before you can go and try to fix it. And the way that you can do that is by kind of going through and just manually testing the application, or ideally running automated tests that you would have built before. Of course, that's kind of a whole different video, but regardless, that is step number one, isolate the problem. All right, so now that you have isolated the problem and you understand what is actually going on, you need to start fixing it. Now, this point here is going to seem obvious, but the next thing you should do is check your variable names. Now, I cannot tell you how many times I have spent hours trying to debug something just to realize I had a duplicate variable name, I defined a variable here, the variable was defined as the wrong type, the variable maybe was holding some random value that I didn't want it to have. Just check your variable names, make sure everything's spelled correctly, make sure the casing is proper, make sure you don't have duplicate variables, or maybe you're referencing a different value than you thought you were. This is probably the most common issue for me, at least when I'm writing code, is variable names. Really, that's where most of my errors are coming from. And so make sure you check through those and do that first, because that is almost always going to be one of the root causes of your problem. And well, obviously, if you can get that out of the way at the beginning, that is going to save you a lot of time, assuming that is what the problem is. So step number two, or checklist item number two, check your variable names. So you've isolated the problem, you've checked your variable names, and the problem still exists. Well, what do? You move on to checklist item number three, which is to check your imports and dependencies. Now, this point here is not necessarily as intuitive as the other ones, and that's because a lot of times you can actually have a problem that is not anything related to what you've done. It's none of your code at all. It's actually just an issue with one of your dependencies or with one of your imports. Now, this happens to me all of the time, and it's the most frustrating thing in the world. Because a lot of times when you're using some type of dependency, especially a module or framework that's pretty popular, you assume that everything in there is just going to work. And you assume that by calling this function and doing what the documentation says, you're going to be fine. But a lot of times there is actually issues in these frameworks and dependencies. And I cannot tell you how many times I've been trying to solve an error for about 3-4 hours just to realize that I actually cannot fix the problem because it exists in the dependency that I'm trying to use. So what you should really do is when you have some type of problem, look up that problem and relate it to the different dependencies that you have. See if you can find any GitHub forums or GitHub issues. See if you can find anything on Stack Overflow that states that there's an issue with this module, and make sure you're looking at stuff like the versions and see if maybe the feature you're trying to use is deprecated. All kinds of problems occur all the time with specifically dependencies, and you can have conflicting dependencies. You could be importing the wrong name. You could be using the wrong function. And just to give you a really real example here of what actually happened to me and why I'm adding this onto the list, because it's pretty important. During my coding live stream that I did, I guess that would have been about 2 months ago, I had this issue with Flask. So I was using Flask and I was trying to set up sockets, web sockets, and I was using Flask Socket.io. But from Flask Socket.io, there was two send methods. There was a send method that I could use by directly importing it from Flask.io, or there was a send method I could use by typing flask.io.send. Now, I was using the wrong send method. I assumed the two send methods were the same because why would they have duplicate send methods? But it turns out the one I was using just didn't work. It was just broken. It had been deprecated inside of Flask Socket.io. And while I spent 3 or 4 hours debugging the entirety of my program just to realize that the issue was actually not from me, it was from my lack of understanding of the documentation, or really kind of the ambiguous send methods that they had. So that's a really real problem. You guys can go watch me do that on the live stream if you want. It was very, very painful to go through and find that, but that is why this is on this list. So you followed the three steps at this point, isolated the problem, checked your variable names, and you've looked at your dependencies and seen if there's any known problems with those dependencies or versions or deprecations or anything like that, and you still have the problem. Well, checklist item number 4 is to use a debugger. Use all of the automated tools in the world to go through, step through your program, and start trying to figure out the exact code block or area of your code where this problem actually is. Again, it's very, very difficult to solve problems if you're not sure where the problem is. So it's great to isolate the problem and figure out what feature or functionality is wrong and know how to replicate that. But you need to know where about in your code base this problem actually exists. And using a debugger is a great way to slow down the program execution, step through your code one line at a time or one function call or whatever at a time, and really figure out what is actually going wrong by viewing the entire internal state of your program. Now, if you've not used a debugger before, it can kind of seem like this very complicated and difficult tool to use. It's not. It's built into almost every IDE or tool that you would actually use. And I have an entire tutorial teaching you how to use a debugger, so you can check that out if you want. I'll leave a link to it somewhere on the screen and in the description. But a debugger is a great tool. There's a lot of other tools you can use as well, like the sponsor of this video that I talked about previously, that help you find issues and bugs in your code. So use them and try to figure out where about the actual problem is. And usually by using a debugger, it's very clear and simple to see where the problem is. You can go and fix it and you can be happy. All right, so you've tried everything that I've mentioned so far, still isn't working. What is the next step? Well, unfortunately, the next step is to just start messing around with the logic in your program and debugging the logic. So this is kind of the worst case here. You've gone through everything. It wasn't a variable issue. It wasn't a dependency issue. It wasn't something you could easily capture with the debugger, sorry. And so what you need to do now is start looking at the logic in your program and realize where there's a logical mistake or where something is going wrong. Now, at this point in time, you kind of just have to figure this out on your own. I can't really give you any great steps in terms of trying to debug the logic. What you can do, though, is try to test parts of your application in isolation and understand what is working and what's not working. You can do this simply by taking out one function or one method, testing that, right? And seeing if that's actually giving you the expected output, using some simple test cases, maybe using some more advanced or edge cases, and just going through bits of your program, assuming you kind of know the general area to be looking at, and figure out what's working and what's not working. As soon as you find the part that is not working, right, that is not giving you the correct result, then you can start trying to debug that by changing around logic. Maybe you have to rewrite the entire thing. I don't know what you're going to have to do, but that is kind of the steps that I would follow. I would kind of test everything one at a time, check off all the things I know are 100% working, and then focus my attention on what is maybe more complicated and what needs a deeper look in terms of fixing the logic. Now, one great way to do this that saves you from having to manually test every single one of these things is to write automated test cases. If you're at the point where you have a very difficult bug and you're going to be going around and messing with a ton of stuff in your program, it might be worth your time to sit down, write a few automated tests, and just run those tests after you make a change. That way, you'll be able to very quickly see what works and what doesn't work. And trust me, that's going to save you a lot of time as you go through the debugging process. Automated tests are also very easy to write. You don't need to do anything super complicated. Just test a few functions, methods, whatever, and make sure you can just kind of run all of those tests at the end so you're not wasting time constantly manually testing. All right, so you've done all of that. You're banging your head on the table. You cannot fix the bug. What do you do next? Well, you may not like this answer, but honestly, it is what works for me the best. Take a break and try again tomorrow or try again later. That is point number 6 on the checklist. If you've done all of that, you've gone through and you've checked everything that you need to check, you've looked at the logic, you've used the debugger, you've checked the variable names, you've looked at your dependencies, and you still can't find it, you need a mental break. I have spent so much time trying to find bugs, hours, maybe even days, just like looking for bugs. And then all of a sudden I take a break, I relax, I don't think about it for a little bit. I come back to it, and I'm sure you guys have all had this before, instantly find the bug. And I'm like, wow, that was a stupid bug. If I had just taken a 10-minute break, maybe walked around, maybe had a good night's sleep, I would have been able to find that easily, sorry. But rather, I was stubborn, selfish, just sat there and tried to crank out and fix the bug. And while I couldn't do it in that state of mind, I really just needed a break. This is a huge one. Honestly, whenever you find you're running into a lot of issues or there's a bug that's just really difficult to find, seriously consider just stopping, taking a break. Doesn't have to be for a long time, maybe half an hour, go for a walk, come back to it. Chances are you're going to be in a better state of mind and able to find that a lot easier. Also, you can kind of have your perspective drilled into one thing that you think is the issue when it's something completely different. And by kind of taking a little break, you can reset that, get rid of the tunnel vision, and hopefully find the bug. All right, so with that said, that is going to end this video. Those are kind of my tips, tricks, and checklist points for trying to debug code. Now, if any of you guys have any other points you want to add to this list, please do leave them in the comments down below. I hope you enjoyed. If you did, make sure to leave a like, subscribe to the channel, and I will see you in another one.